of information. And in the course of fighting several of the carriers who have tried to locate in inappropriate places in Sudbury, we've also had studies done. In one study, we engaged an appraisal firm to determine if the existence of a microwave transmitter in a neighborhood would affect property values. The appraisal firm determined that the existence of a microwave transmitter, whether with stealth technology or not, would affect property values by a negative 5% to 15%. I think that's a serious amount of money for people to take and swallow so that we can have better telecommunication services. The second thing is the residential character of the town will suffer if these facilities are placed in inappropriate places. Stealth technology or not, we don't need microwave transmitters in residential neighborhoods. The third thing relates to the health issues. I think that the committee that drafted this bylaw is placing far too narrow a reading on the Telecommunications Act of 1996. The Telecommunications Act did not repeal the Constitution of the United States, and we have a right to protect ourselves and our property. The town, in going to this very limited interpretation, may in fact be opening itself to lawsuits on civil rights grounds. The third thing that we have turned up is that there is a substantial body of scientific literature on the adverse effects of microwaves. That body of literature is growing. The adverse effects in laboratory animals include single and double-strand DNA breaks in exposed organisms, lymphomas, and epidemiologic studies suggest that there is an increased incidence of leukemia in human populations living near TV and FM broadcast towers. There is a major study underway in the Boston area to determine why there is such a high incidence of breast cancer in the areas near television and FM towers located in Newton and Needham, Massachusetts. We don't know what the result will be, but we got some fairly strong clues. Further research in the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe indicates that there are significant behavioral and learning and motor and psychological function impairment in school children living near radar installations. I think that the best thing you can do, because this is such a rapidly changing situation, there are major suits in federal court, and there is an action that is being heard in the second court in the Second Circuit in New York this coming January, challenging a number of the things that I've touched on. The best thing that you can do right now is to not take any action on this. We have a limited amount of tower space and a location here in Cape Elizabeth. If the carriers want to sue us in the meantime, that's okay. I can tell you it doesn't hurt to be sued. It does require that you engage attorneys, but sometimes you win. I think the best thing you can do is table this thing for a while and let's see what sorts out in the courts. Thank you.
My name is Brian Walker. I live on 18 Cottage Farms Road, and I think it's safe to say that I will probably not be repeating anything that anyone else has said earlier, because I would like to provide a different perspective. First of all, I'd like to thank you for your efforts in drafting the amendments, and it's a lot of work, it's a complicated issue. What I've done, apologize for jumping around here, I've just taken some notes in response to comments that have been made, and I'm just going to address a couple of these. First of all, I guess there's an underlying assumption that there's an adverse health issue. I mean, that's what we'd all tend to believe because, you know, there are a lot of reports about electromagnetic fields and this. Everyone has it in their house. Your common household outlet emits it. If you laid down next to it for probably a year, you'd probably develop cancer. I mean, it is around us, but I also want to make sure that we focus on fact and not on fear. I think that as far as promoting the health and safety of the town, which is a charter, there's also another side of this, and that is increasing communication is not necessarily a bad thing. When we have power outages, I'm not sure how many of you, when we experienced power outages last year, found out that your phones didn't work because very few of us have the old-fashioned kind that don't require power. A cell phone might have been an answer to get help or, you know, to alert somebody, if get information. Also, another health issue is, as mobile communications expand, which is a good thing that would come out of this, it mobilizes our workforce and allows us to reach areas that and communicate more effectively. Currently, there's very poor wireless service in Maine, and one of the things that's currently being done, as you can imagine, is we have people, salespeople on the road, we have environmental people on the road, we have a lot of people on the road right now who are driving around the state, and you know, you might be sent out on a on your route for the day, and you drive around, you come back, you find out that you need to readdress the situation, you go back out on the road. We have all these people out on the roads, the car emissions, that brings up another issue. If you had cell phone communications widely over the state, you could eliminate some of that kind of environmental impact by effectively communicating with people on the road. One thing that, you know, we look at the zoning map, and it's Cape Elizabeth is a residential issue, is a residential area, but I believe that all of us are affected by business issues here. When we have any kind of service calls, people are coming out in our residential area to take care of our service needs. And in having proper communication, effective communication is how they go about serving us. One comment I'd like to throw out as a positive thing here, as far as comment was made about, is there going to be, you know, do we have to do this until there's the next technological leap? And, you know, cell towers aren't forever. One of the solutions that's forthcoming in the next few years actually was launched. It's in place now, and we can hope that it gains support, is that it's satellite communications for the same purpose. And that takes the towers out of our backyards and puts them in geosynchronous orbit. And that, at first glance, that sounds good, but then there's other issues. When that happens, what are the issues that we need to be concerned about? Now we have an overlay area of the whole United States. Are we going to be concerned about those issues? And I ask you to please look at these issues and look at them with concern, but also find out the facts and not make decisions based on fears. And if there are health issues, I would like to be the first to know about it. I mean, I have those same concerns, and I will back any efforts that, if we have to, you know, fight the federal government on these kind of issues and prove that there are health issues, then by all means, let's do it. But if there aren't, then I would like to enjoy the advancements in technologies and how they promote the health and safety of our town. Thank you.
My name is Dave Scheffler, and I'm not with this large group that lives in this area over here, but I'm a lone voice in the wilderness from this green area over here. It occurs to me that if we don't have the great numbers of houses, and so therefore our voice is apt to be not as strong and not heard as much. But one of the things that concerns me is that there are a number of towers already in this location, and if it's an easy and obvious place to put more and more towers, and as technology improves and people find ways to get further out from this area with more power and cover more and more of the town, it's going to subject those of us that live right across the street from this and others in that area to higher and higher levels of this radiation and various types of power that's going to be going out of these towers. And so I'd like to propose that we try to solve the problem with not just two big overlay districts, but an awful lot of smaller ones. And rather than make this area a wasteland, if you will, and make it the easy spot to put more and more of these things, let's try to spread things around and do more of this stealth and smaller locations and get the coverage that way. Thank you.
I'm Peter Eastman, property owner of Turkey Hill Farm, which is adjacent to the Armstrongs and some of these others. I am not pro, I am not con. I have simply worked in electronics at some levels most of my life, Navy and otherwise. One of the things is you can't put these just any place. These are not for submarine races. These only work if they are up high. And the area here was proposed by the Water District, Old John's Hill, or Blue Hill as it shows up in the old charts, is at 120 feet. It's the highest spot around. As I come in from sea on the lightship Nantucket, what do I see? The Turkey Hill Farm and the tower up there. I don't see the tower, but the whole area. And the location over at Herb Strout's site also. You have to be high for things to work. You're talking microwaves, they go in a straight line. They don't go down into holes very well. They don't come out of holes worth a darn. Some comment was made about the traffic on Avon Road. There would be, of course, during the construction era, but not once they get in place. I had a complaint the other day about the kids and motorcycles going in and out of Avon Road. It's from the police. And I'm trying to address that as soon as I can. I found evidence of various certain things going on in my woods there. I want the woods open for the public to enjoy on foot, not on motor vehicle. There's the inverse square law, which says that as you increase the distance from a radiating source, the energy that you get from it is reduced by the square of that distance. If you're twice as far away, you get 1/4. If you're three times as far away, you get 1/9. This means that you're apt to get much more radiation from your own equipment, your own cell phone, your own whatever it is, my 2-meter amateur radio, than you will from the tower. The tower's, if you're going to have it up 180 feet, that's a lot farther away from you than talking this way in your cell phone. I'm not trying to downgrade the concerns of the mass here. I'm simply trying to put some of my experience from way past. And I would also like a lot of people to consider who are concerned about the health effects. Do they smoke?
Thank you.
Neither do I better than
16. Good evening. My name is Ed McCall, and I live on 4 Avon Road. And I first heard about this, I tried to pick... Good evening, Judge McNichol. I didn't even know you were a Cape resident until I saw you in the city. I didn't even realize, didn't know anything about this until I first heard about it. So I've tried to figure out what is proposed for the end of my street, my road. And I made some phone calls. I talked to Maureen briefly. I've spoken to the town attorney. I've read the proposed ordinance. I've brought to light on the benefit of that reading 4 years of college and 3 years of law school. And I don't know what's proposed for the end of my road. You've got an overlay district that applies to a 0.52 acre lot that doesn't meet the setback requirements that are in the overlay district. I don't know whether the setback requirements apply to placing antenna on the outside of the tower. It's clear to me you can't add to the tower. I don't know whether anything is proposed to be done or what's contemplated to be done for the tower. So I made some more calls and asked some more questions. I called people who drafted the ordinance, one of whom, Larry Clough, spoke tonight. He's a former partner of mine. I said, Larry, I've read the ordinance. I don't understand what's proposed for this tower lot because of these observations I've made. He said, Those are good observations. I don't know any of the answers. I've spoken to three or four other people and said, I don't understand what can be done at the end of my road in light of my observations about this ordinance. And all of them have said, those are good observations. I don't know the answer, up to and including the town's regular attorney, Michael Hill. That leaves me in a position of not knowing what my response to the proposal is, other than to say, if I were sitting where you're sitting and I was asked to say, is this a good idea or a bad idea, the first thing I'd want to ask is, what's the idea? And so far, nobody's been able to tell me what the idea is. It'd be pretty clear to me that until somebody could answer that question, how is using this water tower going to address the concerns, whatever they are, I couldn't be in favor of the idea. The general idea of the ordinance is that towers should not be in neighborhoods. In fact, the general idea of the ordinance is towers shouldn't be in the town of Cape Elizabeth other than in two places. There's a lot of places on this map that would cover the area you want to cover that aren't in anybody's backyard, where you could place a tower tall enough, whether it's on a hill or not, to provide the required coverage that wouldn't raise the concerns about poisoning kids nearby. That wouldn't raise the, we talked about squaring the distance and reducing the danger. You could place a lot of towers on this map and have no danger anywhere nearby. Nicholas Parsons' bedroom is about 150 feet from that water tower. You don't need to place any kids 150 feet from these microtransmitters. And I think if you look at the map and try to place it, try to place any proposed towers in an area where you don't raise these concerns, I think you could do it pretty easily in the town of Cape Elizabeth. We're very fortunate. We have a lot of open space in this town. As it happens, Shore Acres doesn't provide that open space. And therefore, I'd be concerned about putting towers in. But to get back to my starting point, I don't know whether a tower is even contemplated, because as I read the ordinance, you couldn't do it. And I don't know what's planned for the end of the road, but I hope that before we change the zoning laws and try to address this concern, the people who actually vote on the proposal will at least know what they're voting on. Right now, I don't understand what the proposal is. Thank you.
I'm Sheila Mayberry. I live at 8 Waben Road. We just moved here a year ago, and already I'm really proud of my people on the town council and the board. However, I, along with the concerns that everyone has raised, one of the biggest concerns I have is the response that was given to why the federal and state governments were not approached when they were talking about Two Light State Park. Please give us justice when you are looking at this. Don't discriminate against us when you haven't even approached the federal and state governments yet about a perfect site, it seems to me, since you haven't ruled it out. So before you make any decisions, please contact the state and federal agencies, if this is what you're going to do, and see what their response is. If you don't know, don't put us in a position of making us take action that we would not like to take if this were passed. Thank you very much.
Would anyone else like to come forward?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would specifically like to hear from amateur radio operators. There's a whole section in the ordinance that deals with them with respect to regulations. I don't mean whatsoever to preempt the either issues from residents from the town or whatever, but if there are people who are radio amateur radio operators who are waiting, I think I've gotten a good, I've heard, I mean, it's all starting to sound very familiar, and I've heard loud and clear what the issue is with this specific neighborhood, and I don't mind continuing to hear, but I would like to hear from any amateur radio operators, if there are any in the crowd that would like to step forward.
Well, I'm not one of those, but...
Because I only saw one or two hands go up, and I don't want them to feel that their issue, if they have one this evening, is not pertinent to this discussion.
You can still speak.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wilcox. My name is Russ Keenan. I live at 3 Spoondrift Lane, but I also have a connection with Avon Road and the Shore Acres community in that we own the property right adjacent to the Armstrongs and right across the street from the Water District Tower. In fact, we own the other tower on Avon Road. It's a 70-foot high tower, the old sub tower. And I also don't understand what's in the statute. And even professionally being an environmental consultant, and in fact, I should mention that my background is in analyzing health effects from exposures to environmental agents. And I'm the vice president of Ogden Environmental Services and their principal toxicologist. But since we can't talk about those issues tonight, I just wanted to make it perfectly clear that on my 4.5-acre property, I've chosen not to subject the residents, my friends, neighbors, and family to the impacts of these transmitters. And so if the Water District Tower property is too small to place a tower on it, I don't want anyone to think that my property is open to such a use. I will forego that income because clearly the community does not want such a tower there. And I would urge you to reject this proposal. I think one of the earlier speakers mentioned it quite adequately when he said that why subject the residents of Shore Acres, and I would say also Broad Cove Road and Broad Cove neighborhood, to diminished property values when you have a siting area which is not going to be sufficient to take such a tower in the first place. And given that my property with a 70-foot tower across the street is not available, I think that ought to close the issue. Thank you for your time.
Good evening. My name is Joe Parson, 9 Avon Road. I'm dead set against having microwave towers 145 feet, not 150 feet, from my son Nicholas's bedroom. I would urge you to look at some of the 800 acres that the town uses, and please utilize that and not basically my side lawn. Thank you.
If there's an amateur radio operator here who would care to give us their impression of the proposal.
Well, I'm still Pete Eastman from Turkey Hill Farm. I don't think I'm schizophrenic. Anyway, I am not a good example for the amateur community because my interest, if I ever got away from things like the Maine Narrow Gauge Railroad and the Lightship in Nantucket and the Red Cross and had some time to do ham radio, would be to go out in the pucker brush, put up a temporary antenna, and operate for a little while, and then go home. But I know that, before I forget it, I would like to commend Maureen O'Meara for trying to digest the technicalities of this business. I am currently reading through the regulations required to renew one's amateur license. It's about 70 pages of, you don't want to know. But anyway, most amateur operators who go in for long-distance communications, and they do a good public service with this in many ways, do want height. And 50 feet is kind of minimum for a long-range amateur radio antenna. Amateur waves are all over the spectrum, from 1.8 megacycles to way up into the microwaves. 1.8 is just above your AM broadcast band. So they would shoot me if I said, well, what I had at home was an antenna that went up beside my chimney and off to the pine tree. I don't think it's hurt the pine tree any. But they want high towers. And I think, I haven't read in detail the federal preemption, but I think it does put severe restrictions on what towns, municipalities, organizations can do to them. That's under the FCC.
on the matter of the health effects. It's not that towns don't have anything to say about it so much. They don't have the resources to research it, as the federal is doing. I know we don't like to trust the federal. We like to trust the federal government, but often we don't, as well as the state government, sometimes the municipals. But this is an area where it would take millions and millions of dollars, which most taxpayers don't want to put up, to research the whole health aspects of this. So I think municipalities have to depend on the federal research in order to get their guidelines. Trust is a weird thing, but anyway.
Would anyone else care to come to the podium and offer some comments?
I might say I railed about 30 years ago in this room against paving and making superhighways out of some of the Cape roads. I said at the time, what that is going to accomplish, and I don't need a PA system, is things are going to go faster and we're going to have more wrecks. And I know we had it within 1 week. We had, on a Tuesday and a Thursday, we had accidents on the Mitchell Road S-curve. People wanted to straighten it out. My comment was, you can make it straight right out to the lobster shack and then clock them as they go over the rocks.
We can't protect ourselves from anything.
Thank you. Any other comments for the board?
I'd just like the board to know that I think they should take everything in that has been considered tonight into concerns for the town, and especially Shore Acres, where this tower may be put, whatever tower it is. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to speak?
What is the height above? Can you see that with the town down?
Whew.
A nice sight. Nobody lives there. But where do we have?
385.
Right, we're talking 120, 140.
It's like a steeple in the church is probably as good as anything you can get. That's good height, and that covers.
Mr. Chairman, I don't think we're going to solve this issue tonight. I think we should defer that issue to another. Whatever we decide to do this evening, we can take additional time to look up the specific answer to that.
Yes.
You have it? Shoot, is it NVGD datum?
No, it's just in contours.
Okay.
It's at elevation 71. Just to give you a reference, let's see. The water tower at Avon Road is at contour 120.
The public hearing is still open. Would anyone else care to offer some comments? None being heard, I'll close the public hearing. And the board can now begin discussion on what to do. Mr. Emery.
Mr. Chairman, for the public record, as the planning board already knows, I have an abutter who has two amateur radio towers and are probably the second tallest towers in town. As I've said in the past, my concerns lie with the issue of neighbors being involved in terms of getting building permits. This regulation states that anything below 50 feet, one can erect a tower with just a building permit. There are issues in terms of guy wires and so forth. For the public record, I want the public to know I do not have a prejudice one way or the other. I just want to be sure that the process is thorough. This evening, we've heard from a neighborhood group. I have no desire whatsoever to let this matter rest with the quietest neighborhood group, just as we heard with the gentleman that lives adjacent to the existing towers. I think sometimes it can be a tendency where the squeaky wheel gets all the grease, And I fully support the public process, and I'm very much encouraged to see people here this evening. We've had equally, as I think, difficult issues to deal with where we haven't heard from people, and we've assumed that they're at home watching on television so that the hall doesn't have to be filled as much. What I'm trying to say is I don't want to have to go through the Brentwood neighborhoods, the Shore Acres neighborhoods, all the other neighborhoods trying to relocate this tower. I think my preference this evening would be to table this item, bring it back to workshop if appropriate, and either make a recommendation that further study be done by a committee to look at site locations appropriate for tower overlay districts, taking in all considerations, and let it rest with that. There may be other aspects of this ordinance that can be forward to the council, or we can forward it to the council without a recommendation for a specific location with the overlay district, but rather request that the council form another study committee to deal with that issue. Mm-hmm. But I had several issues that I've heard that I think we need the issue of clarification on the issue of nonconformance. I have concerns with the issue of particularly as the technology changes, if particularly where we now have increasing intrusion in residential neighborhoods for business uses, in-home business, we have accessory apartments. This is an extremely attractive income source. If one has a 35-foot house and one can put an appurtenance on the house, such as a belfry or a cupola, a widow's walk, whatever, and conceal within that three antennas and go to the commercial business, I don't see anything in here other than going through the process that precludes one from doing that. Essentially, that would allow a commercial use within a residential zone. I think we should be very clear on that when we make the recommendation to the council. The issue of state parks, federal and state lands, I would hate to open up the paper tomorrow and say Cape residents don't want it in their backyard, but they sure don't mind having it in the state park or next to the bird sanctuary, the natural open space in the middle of town, or in a church steeple. So I think we have to, again, I think it warrants further study. I think it warrants further study to have a very clear understanding of the issue of federal regulations and what we can't do with respect to the health issues. Health, safety, and welfare is at the basis of zoning. And if it's at all possible, and perhaps Mr. Carter could comment on this, but if there has already been enormous research done on the difference between microwave and if microwave applies to this, or one has to assume that perhaps it may not be the immediate use on a tower, but it could become a future use. I think that may deserve more discussion either at the council subcommittee level or at one of our workshop meetings. And again, I heard everything this evening. I think the residents spoke very clearly about their concerns. I can't help but want to sit at the gateway of Shore Acres or any other neighborhood in town and see how many people got the cell phone in their ear going to work in the morning. There's a bit of a hypocrisy here, but the way I deal with this issue is that because I use gasoline in my automobile to get from point A to B doesn't mean I need an oil well in my backyard. So perhaps that's the same thing. Because one uses a cell phone or other technology doesn't mean that one actually has to live underneath that tower. But I certainly want to be sure that these regulations are fair to all neighborhoods in Cape Elizabeth, and it's not the quietest neighborhood ends up getting the tower site.
Anybody else have a comment in that line?
Just yes, a question from Maureen. Do we have any timetable that we have to get this back to the council by?
No. Mr. Chairman, we've had a lot of material tonight, and I, for one, would like to have a chance to reflect on it before making any hard and fast decision one way or the other as to whether we're going to approve part of this or all of this.
For the public's information, one of the things that's built into the proposed ordinance, which we have tried to, in crafting the ordinance, not rely on, is there is an ability within the ordinance if a provider feels that they can't cover part of the town, and they want to come to town, and they find, and they want to pick their own place, and they can find a landowner who will accommodate them, they can then apply to the town council, and we can go through the whole process all over again for establishing a custom tower overlay zone, so that we can say in our ordinance we haven't prohibited towers from being able to serve the population that needs them. And I think that that is something that the issues that were raised about what can be done in the designated overlay zones are something that we should look at before we go only, you know, with proposing a definite overlay zone, and which even in itself doesn't preempt the former approach where a provider would just come to town and say, I want to put a tower here, this landowner is leasing me enough land to do it, and here we go. We were trying to get a little more control over the situation than that by I think the committee tried to propose something that would give service without giving as great a negative impact as could appear in some neighborhoods if a tower ended up in some neighborhoods. But I think that's something for us to look at in workshop also. Maybe it does. Yes. Tom was first.
I apologize for backtracking, but one issue that I have in capital letters on the top of my paper here is comprehensive plan. Maureen made an excellent presentation and summary of this whole issue, and I thought she summarized the issues extremely well. I think the board, if this goes back to workshop, should also look at the language in the comprehensive plan, because it's almost, I don't know how to describe this, but it's almost something has been regulated upon us, and now we have to go back and reconstruct our comprehensive plan so that all of the zoning is promulgated legally and appropriately. I think the purpose statement of the comprehensive plan, if it doesn't, and I apologize for not being familiar with it under this specific item, but if it doesn't specifically refer to the federal requirements to accommodate so on and so forth, I don't think that this, if we had a subcommittee of the comprehensive planning committee, that we'd get 200 residents to come to a public forum and all volunteer that there's a lot of good sites in Cape Elizabeth to accommodate these towers. I think a lot of what's driving this issue is the fact that we have to, or else. Yeah.
I would point out to the people here, who perhaps this didn't come out during the discussion, was that one of the reasons coverage is a problem is one of the basic underlying assumptions of the proposed ordinance is that no tall towers with lights will be allowed, period, anywhere in town. Otherwise, coverage providers would come to town, similar to in Freeport, and propose 300 and 400 foot towers to get the coverage. And that's where we started from, was that anything at 200 feet or over needs blinking lights on top of it for the FAA, and we set the cap town-wide at 180 feet, just so that there'd be no sort of margin of error in that, which leads us in workshop to look more at other approaches. Yes, Nancy.
Question for our chairman or Maureen or anybody who wishes to answer. How much latitude do we have over the copy that we were presented with by the committee that explored the... How much latitude do we have to change
Complete
it?
Complete latitude.
What?
Complete latitude.
Complete latitude.
Town Council also has complete latitude over what we recommend also. We could point out at that also. Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion. Be it ordered that the zoning ordinance tower amendments, tower overlay district rezoning, and comprehensive plan tower amendments be returned to workshop for further study.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? I have a question for Maureen before we move on. Our application, the application packet with the ordinance shows the two proposed overlay zones which came to us. The third one, there's no diagram of it, and it slips my mind when it was presented to us before. Tell us when that was born.
The third one was born about a week ago. The fire chief realized that in the work over the Leverett property and creation of the new public works facility, they have evolved with this decision that, gee, wouldn't it be nice if all the public safety communications could be handled on a tower that would exist on the Leverett property? So he called me last week and he said, did we make provisions for that? And I said, no. And he said, well, what should I do? And I said, well, if you want the planning board to zone that, a tower overlay district, then you better write me a letter really quick. And that's what he's done. And I believe, I have it, I haven't given to you, I've got to get it, but the yellow area that's shown on that map is what is being proposed. And he's asking for you to designate that a tower overlay district. His statement is that it would be used for municipal uses only.
I think that alone merits examination and workshop. Yes, Dave.
Just to help us, Mr. Chairman, in our effort to understand and think about some of the subjects that were issued tonight, I wanted to ask Peter or Maureen a question as to when the overlay districts were set up, were they based, what was the parameter that the diameter or the radius was set at?
I believe that we were working with a 2-mile radius, because all of our reading, and I think Peter will back me up at this, there's no way to overstate the technical complexity of this issue. And really the only way to get a firm grasp of where, how much service area you can cover from a particular site, is to actually hire engineers and have them drive around with a radio, and they run a crane 180 feet up in the air with a repeater, and they drive around and they measure what they can cover. And this committee had neither the time nor any kind of the resources to do that. There are things that staff are certainly willing to throw themselves into, and then there are areas where you're so completely over your head there's no potential to even try. So we used the 2-mile radius, which seemed to be reasonable. I believe we were fortunate in that we had a resident of the community who has a significant amount of experience from the 1940s with operating these types of facilities, and he provided us with a lot of advice. His son provided us with a lot of advice, basically along the lines of, you know, that's really out of it, or you're in the ballpark. So that's why we use the 2 miles. The reason you have the green circle and then that kind of odd-shaped area inside is because when the planning board was looking at a site plan approval for an additional antenna at the existing site on Spurwink Ave, that particular provider, or you know, telecommunication service provider, had done the study, because there was no more room on the taller tower, and he was trying to figure out whether they could accommodate themselves on a smaller tower. And we were able to get that information because we asked for it, and he didn't want to say no. It's not the kind of thing we normally get, but I put it on there just to show that topography can have a major impact. It's you know, Mr. Peterson was right. The height, the location of the site in terms of the height in the town is an important factor. Another important factor is just what the topography is. You can have a really high site and a hill between you and 300 feet away, and you won't get coverage over there. And also the height of the tower. You know, if you have a very high tower, obviously you the topography becomes less important. But the town had decided that we did not want to have the blinking lights and red lights that are required by the FAA for towers of 200 feet or higher. So we're proposing a limit, a maximum limit of 180 feet. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. Thank you.
One of the topics which I think has come to light this evening that bears to be discussed in workshop is the concept of multiple towers, sort of more ugly that's smaller as opposed to fewer ugly that's taller throughout the town, which perhaps is a valid consideration. But just for the information of those present here, a lot of people are of the opinion that the town of Cape Elizabeth should not be in the business of providing cellular telephone service in the private sector as a governmental entity. And if you feel the town should be, that's something that really is not a land use issue, but a governmental policy issue about government entities competing with private sector businesses. And if you want to take that up with other town boards, you know, maybe there is a good idea there. I don't know. Any other?
But it is a land use issue.
But it would be a land use issue no matter where it appears, and we need to look at the height and the impact. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion on the tabling?
Clarification, would this be referred to the January workshop meeting?
Yes. Now let's see what we've got. Is it really full?
Do you want to vote?
Fit it in. Well, unless it's further discussion, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the tabling motion, raise your right hand. Motion is tabled. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming. We have another public hearing coming up, but perhaps not as long. Okay, thank you. Okay. Item for the board to discuss. Do you want to press on at this point in time if no one has come for the public hearing on our last item and postpone it to the January meeting? Or do you want to just do it and take the extra 5 or 10 minutes that it takes to deal with it? We have the final item on the agenda is the zoning ordinance technical amendments, and we do have a public hearing scheduled for that for this evening.
Didn't you go through the motion anyway?
Okay. I need to do what to the rules?
I believe that your planning board regulations say that you don't take up any new items after 10 o'clock, so you'd need a motion to suspend the rules.
Okay. Would anyone?
So moved.
Well, what do we move?
We have a motion to suspend the rules, which say we can't take up new items of business after 10 o'clock.
I use the local ordinance. I may have to recuse myself on this item.
Do we have a second?
I will second, Mr. Wilcox.
We have a motion and a second that says we can continue the meeting longer. Huh. Any discussion on the motion?
No. Make it quick.
Let's hurry up.
Okay.
Do we have a time limit of 10 o'clock? Is that right?
Yes. We have rules that say we don't take up new items of business after 10 o'clock.
That's what needs to be seen.
Okay. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. We have it raised. The last item on the agenda is the zoning ordinance technical amendments. And just for those of you who may still be watching, if you've made it with us, we have a recommendation by the Planning Board for miscellaneous clarifying amendments to the zoning ordinance to be reviewed tonight for recommending to Town Council, similar to our last item on the agenda. Again, to be reviewed tonight under section, and to include section 19-10-3, public hearing. I will allow Maureen to present these
For the board's
to the public.
For the board's information, these are one of the first amendments we've been able to add to the webpage. So for at least 2 weeks, all of these amendments, as well as the tower amendments, have been on the town's webpage so that anyone could look at them. There was also an article in the Cape Courier notifying people that they exist. For that reason, I am not going to go through each and every item. I will merely state that these are intended to be clarifying amendments to revise, improve, an ordinance that was adopted slightly over a year ago. There are no major policy changes. There are a few minor policy changes.
Would you mind pointing out the policy changes?
I did that for you. I'm sorry.
Yes, I can do that. I believe the major policy changes have to do with the home workshop and the home business definitions. Right now, home businesses are allowed in main buildings, but not in accessory structures. And there are amendments here that would allow them to occupy a portion of an accessory structure. There's also a provision in here that would change the way that conditional use applications are reviewed that also requires site plan review by the planning board. Currently, all conditional uses have to be reviewed by the zoning board, and then if they require site plan review, they're reviewed by the planning board. Staff is recommending that we streamline the process and have, when an application requires both reviews, that both reviews be conducted by the planning board. Zoning board has endorsed this heartily, so we're not taking anything that they don't want to give up. The other change, which again I don't really think is a major policy change, is in the town center district. The maximum lot coverage for school uses is 20%, and we're proposing to increase it to 40%, since it appears that the original numbers that we based the 20% number on were not accurate. I believe those are all of the, what I would call, policy changes.
Thank you.
Mr. Parkhurst.
I have to make a motion.
We have to hold a public hearing.
Public hearing.
Excuse me?
Public hearing?
Public hearing.
Oh, that's right. Go ahead.
At this point in time, now that the amendments have been presented, I'd like to open the public hearing. Anyone present in the audience?
There is someone.
And we're losing people rapidly here. We're down to the bitter end, who would like to come forward and offer comments on the proposed zoning technical amendments. Please step up to the microphone. Seeing nobody coming forward, there's no one here. I'll close the public hearing. And we may now enter into substantive discussion of our recommendation.
Let's make a motion. Motion, yes. For the board to consider, be it ordered that the zoning ordinance technical amendments be recommended to the town council for adoption.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Motion carries unanimously.
Another motion.
Final motion, please.
To end the meeting.
Second.
Second. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much, folks.